grace speaks to you from God our Father and from our Lord, Savior Jesus. The section of God's Word that God has brought us today is from the Old Testament, book of Psalms, number 29. Ascribe to the Lord, O mighty ones, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord glory through his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters, glory of God thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon skip like a calf, Syria like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert. The Lord shakes the desert pitch. The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forest bare. And in his temple, all cry glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as king forever. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. And we're pleased to see him. Dear friends,
interacted with important people, local officials, business leaders, and back.
pastors from other countries.
And interacting with influential folks. Is that all you have in mind?
He said, you may want.
Maybe.
Another possibility is this. Remember, David was Italian warrior. And if you were with us during our study of the life of King David, you remember that he had his special forces, just like today, we have our special forces. David had his special forces too. There were 30 soldiers, the best of the best. They were the main man of King David's army.
And you speak to them.
You got the warriors.
Remember to play the war.
Two more possibilities come to mind. The Hebrew word translated mighty ones literally says sons of God. It doesn't say powerful, it doesn't say mighty. I'm not sure why our modern translation chose mighty ones. It literally says sons of God. You children of God. Well, who might that be? Many scholars believe, of course, that this refers to believers, to worshipers of the Lord, and they point to a little bit later in the Psalm where King David invites everybody in his temple, all the worshipers, cry out glory to God. Those would be the believers. So perhaps these sons of God, these mighty ones, if you prefer the English translation, perhaps that's just about all believers. One more possibility is this. Sons of God sometimes doesn't refer to the angels. The context of our reading will tell you, are we speaking about the angels here? Sometimes sons of God refers to the angels. And some scholars believe this is talking about the angels. King David in a scholar psalm invites the angels to praise the Lord, and then towards the end of the psalm, he invites the believers. Everybody in the temple. Well, who no matter if you think it's the influential people, or the mighty warriors, or the angels, or the believers, no matter which interpretation you choose, you know believers aren't true. Because there in the Psalm, or two or three verses before the end, David specifies the believers. Those in the temple, those worshiping the Lord, they are invited to do something. What are they to do? That brings us to our second question. What? Well, they are to praise God. David puts it this way. Ascribe to the Lord glory to his name. Worship him. You know, when you ascribe something to someone, you are giving it to them. You're saying, you are worthy, you are deserving of this. This belongs to you. Ascribe to the Lord the glory that David's not just talking about the old God. Ascribe to the supreme deity the glory to his name. No, David uses a very specific word, the Lord. L-O-R-D in capital letters in your English version of the Bible that lets you know a special Old Testament word is being used for God. It's the name of God, Yahweh, Jehovah. I'm not sure how it should have been pronounced. Two things we've noted about the Lord in previous messages are important here. And one is that he's God who exists. He's a great I am. In fact, his name, the Lord, literally means I am. Remember when Moses said the word in the bush? He said, well, who are you? He's talking to God. Who are you? And God said, I am. Tell people I am sent. Huh? God exists. Jesus took that name for himself in the New Testament. Remember, he was arguing with spiritual leaders in the temple, and he told them, for Abraham was born, I am. The Jewish leaders, they understood exactly what Jesus was. They became angry with him. They picked up stones to stone to death because he claimed to be God. Praise the one God who exists, the Lord. somehow rescuing people, rescuing them from physical danger, promising to send the Savior, sending that Savior, picturing that Savior in the sacrifice. God is rescuing these people. The Lord is the God of grace, the God of love. King David urged people, all people, praise the Lord. King David invites you and me to praise the Lord. We open our service in a wonderful way to children. A little parade for Jesus, didn't they? They open the Bible passages. They help us remember. This is a very special day. We open with songs of praise. We continue with songs of praise. We'll end our service with songs of praise. We want to take it outside. And we want to take the praise outside of the comfort of these walls. And here's where it often becomes difficult. Here's where we often fail. It's pretty easy to praise Jesus here among believers in the confines of the church, but to praise Jesus in our daily lives, at our workplace, at school, wherever it may be, sometimes our praise is a muted in those settings. I wonder how many times the stones cry out, "You are the world!" Now that's the real reason Jesus had to go to Jesus, to take our failures upon himself. And in the ultimate act of praise, to run to Jerusalem to suffer and die for our sins. We've touched upon the food. We've looked at the weather. Here in this building. Outside of this building. We've talked about the what we want to praise the Lord. Let's close with the why. Why praise the Lord? David lists a number of things in a very picturesque way. In a poetry picture like the psalmist to the poet. David talks about the power of God and his rule. He's the King of Kings. He creates some pictures in our mind. First of all, he says the voice of the Lord thunders. Thunder. The vision, the picture here, is of a thunderstorm. We've all witnessed the summer thunderstorm. We've seen the lightning flash across the sky. We've heard the movement. And maybe the wind has broken down trees. Very powerful. It says, like a thunderstorm, that voice is powerful. But you know, David talks about the voice of the Lord. It's really talking about the Lord. Not just the sounds that come out of his mouth, but out of his mouth because of who speaks it. King of Kings. He rules everywhere. Not only a limited territory like in Israel. David brings that out too. That the Lord rules everywhere. Think of how he does that. First of all, he says, the voice of the Lord is over the waters. Over the waters. The largest body of water close to Israel, of course, is the Mediterranean Sea. Right to the west, a massive wave washing ashore. Huge swells swamping ships. Think of the Apostle Paul being shipwrecked in the Mediterranean. The water, it heard over those waters. Paul perhaps David had other waters in mind, too. You can think of the Sea of Galilee, much smaller body of water. Ferocious storms hit that water. Or maybe to think of, in Moses' time, the Nile River, or the Red Sea. Moses' day, of course, those were thought to be controlled by false deities. But at the Lord's command, they became instruments of deliverance. The voice of the Lord is over the waters, whatever the waters may be. I believe King David specifically had in mind the Mediterranean, the water to the west. I say that because of how the song goes on. David goes on. He says, the voice of the Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. Lebanon is up to the north of Israel. It's an obstinate area. Large trees, that is the arid location, but large trees up north toward Lebanon. The voice of the Lord snaps the cedars. I give it on my snap. The Lord rules up north too. But how about to the south and to the east of Israel? Those are the desert regions, right? David speaks about the desert regions. The Lord shakes the desert. Somebody might falsely assume, oh, I can flee from the Lord's power. I walk through the desert. Hold on. The Lord rules there as well. Remember, as the Israelites wandered in the desert, the Lord's voice was heard in the house of Aaron. The west, to the north, to the south, to the east. In other words, everywhere. The Lord is the king of kings. Good reason to praise him. Why praise the Lord? Because he's the King of Kings who rules everywhere. And his rule goes on forever. That's what David said. He's enthroned as king forever. They're usually earthly rulers come and go, right? They live, they flourish, and then they pass away. But not the Lord. No, he's the great I am, God who exists. He rules forever. Good reason to praise him. One more reason that David highlights. This Lord gives blessings to people. The blessings of strength and peace. That's what it says towards the end of the song. He blesses his people with strength. All of the Israelites needed strength. You know, they were loaded down with all the burdens of life. The same thing as you and I share. How can I go on, they might wonder? How can I put food on the table? How can I deal with all the disappointments and discouragement that life has thrown at me? How can I get up tomorrow and go one foot in front of the next and keep on going? Only because the Lord gave them strength. He would give them peace as well. Peace for their souls. Undoubtedly, they wrestled with guilty consciences just like we do. The Lord's message of salvation brought peace to them. The Lord! Granted, God's people, but he's in the way. Strength and peace. Good reason to praise him. We have those same reasons to praise the Lord. You know, Jesus is still King of Kings. And he still rules everywhere, whether it's north or south or east or west. Nations may bow their sabers, but Jesus is in charge. He's the King of Kings, making all things work out for us. That brings peace. The Lord Jesus is in charge. What peace that brings? That we have heaven to bring peace. Now, sometimes we worry and we wonder. We try to take out God's hands, the things that He controls, try to take them for ourselves. Oh, my peace would work. As we trust that Jesus is on the throne, ruling all things, peace reigns in our hearts. Today we remember that Jesus came to give up his life for us then. And we have that spiritual peace. On this Palm Sunday, we have good reason to praise our Lord. We recall that the King set aside that power, that glory, took out human nature, got on top of a donkey, rode into Jerusalem to take our sins upon himself. In this way, Jesus established peace between God and us. We have good reason to spend our whole lives praising Jesus. So, what is your purpose in life? The answers that the world gives say they fall short of being satisfied. In the scriptures, we find the reason God designed us. We find God's answer to that question. What's my purpose? Our fivefold purpose in life is this. We were designed for discipleship. That is to grow in our faith. We were born to be part of His family. We were born to be a blessing to others, to one another. We were made for the mission of outreach. And finally, today, we were prepared for praise. It was grace. It has great power to live out the purpose for which we were created. Because in doing that, we find great satisfaction. We bring blessings to other people. And above all, God's name is Lord. Please, I believe.